Good morning. And welcome to worship at Gracie United Church from the heart of Canada, Winnipeg, Manitoba. Welcome to all those in the congregation here today, and welcome to those online guests joining us live via the internet. I'd like to begin by wishing all the fathers, past and present, all the father-like images and figures in our midst, a very, very happy Father's Day. Also, today is the 45th running of the Manitoba Marathon, and there's 8,000 participants and 1,500 volunteers out there making it happen, so we wish them wellness and safety on their journey. I'd like to begin with a territorial acknowledgement. Today we acknowledge our presence on Treaty 1 land. This is the ancestral land of the Métis Nation, the Anishinaabe, Cree, Oji-Cree, Dene, and Dakota peoples. We are all treaty people, and as settlers, we must walk together with respect and right relationship. I'd like to invite Kathy to come up to begin our announcements.
Good morning. My name is Kathy, and I chair the worship team. And I just wanted to take a moment today to say thank you as we close down the worship season to all of you for supporting us. I realized last night that we've actually made it for a full season from September to June in person, and I'd forgotten about that, so that's awesome. Part of that, and the other thing is that they say you can't say thank you enough. So this morning, I'm going to say a little extra thank you to four individuals. During worship planning, we looked at what we need to do and keep going. And the time with the child within all of us is a big part of our service, whether we have little younger people with us or not. And then at Christmas time last year, Luann says, maybe we can reach out to the families and see if we can get the kids back in the church. And just as I say that, James and David just walked in the door. So awesome. and so we did that. And thanks to a partnership with some volunteers, this all happened. And who can forget Squishy during Lent? And that was wonderful. And we've had cymbals crashed and science experiments and you name it. So thank you. And then the other person that I want to acknowledge today is Diane. When she signed up for the lay leadership course in January last year, what a calling for her and what a blessing for us. I know she had some assignments that she had to do in front of people, but she's done a lot for us that she didn't have to do. So I'd like to call Luann, Greg, Cheryl, Auntie Cheryl, and Diane up front. And Vanna, if you can bring over the bag. Yep, that'd be great. Thank you. Thank you, Vanna. First off, okay, turn around so they can get you on camera. Let's just give them a round of, oh, you got to move to the left. Right, I'm sorry. And I'm away from the mic and I'll get in trouble for that. Sorry, are we okay? Yeah, okay, thank you. Okay, all of you like being outside. All of them like gardening. And I get in trouble when I go to greenhouses. So, I will say though, I've bought them each a plant. You guys can go to the cottage camp and they'll be good. I can guarantee you, they don't need a lot of care. So, just a small thank you.
Aww. Well, thank you. Indoor or outdoor?
No, they're outdoors.
Okay.
We can talk more later. They are sedums. And they come up and they look like broccoli at first, and then they bloom into the fall. So,
they turn red and orange.
Yes, they're different colors. So there you are. So thank you all. We wouldn't have done it without you.
Thank you.
Absolutely. We have a few additional announcements, and I neglected to introduce myself at the beginning. My name is Brent Poole, and I sit on our leadership team. I oversee the outside user church groups for our church, so welcome from me. Next Sunday, June 25th, will be an outdoor service next door at the school grounds, weather permitting, and we'll worship outside the church. This will be the final Sunday of the current worship season. We will be saying thanks to Bob Logan as he retires as our longtime church administrator. So please plan and stay for cake and fellowship after the service next Sunday. July and August returns the Churchorama feature 2023. So see Kathy after church today to get your passport if you're interested in being a part of the Churchorama this summer with all of our To Begin church friends. The worship team would like to welcome Reverend Earl Gould, a good friend, longtime friend of Grace United Church, back to the pulpit, and also Heather Welby Smith, who will be our music accompanist this morning. Thank you for joining us this morning. And we invite everyone here to stay for a light lunch following the service as we wrap up the service at the end. I'll continue with the lighting of the Christ candle. We light this Christ candle as a symbol of the warmth of self-giving, the love that guides us each moment in our living.
The love of God has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit, who has been given to us. Our opening hymn this morning is from Voices United 507, Today we are all called to be disciples.
Thank you.
morning prayer is responsive. Let us pray. The Spirit of God moves among us, binding us in covenant with faithful people of every time and place.
The Spirit serves within us, moving us to proclaim the gospel to all people.
The Spirit moves through us, making us channels of God's love. Can you two people come up? You've sure grown since the last time I was here. How old are you?
Seven.
You're seven.
Okay.
7 and 9. Oh my goodness. It's so great to see you. And do you all remember celebrating Pentecost? Do you know what Pentecost is? Do you have a bit of an idea? It was May 28th, I think, and there would have been a lot of red around the church. And that day we celebrate that God comes to us through Spirit, We can't see God, but we can feel God's presence. And today, there's going to be some pretty special parts that are going to remind us of Pentecost. And the color of Pentecost, do you remember what the main color for Pentecost is?
Red.
You're right! You got it! And so here, why don't you just bounce that around the people and let them play with it a little bit? And we'll just...
Okay, so it's coming to me. Look out. There we go.
And here, I've got a balloon for each of you. To take home with you. Your mom probably doesn't want you to blow it up here now, but put it in your pocket and take it home with you. And there's a few more here if the child in you wants to take a balloon home. Okay? Now, I didn't bring my script, but our hymn is Blessed Assurance, isn't it? Yeah. And Diane, what number is it?
337.
337. Blessed Assurance.
Thank you.
Please join me in prayer. O God, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word is proclaimed, we may hear what you are saying to us today. Amen. Our first scripture and our gospel for the day is from Matthew chapter 9, verse 35, and chapter 10, verse 2, and verses 7 to 8. Verse 35, the harvest is great, the laborers are few. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom and curing every disease and every sickness. Jesus messaged the 12 apostles. Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. As you go, proclaim the good news. The kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out the demons. You received without payment, give without payment. Our second scripture is Paul's letter to the Romans, Romans chapter 8, verses 14 to 17, and verses 24 to 28. God's promise realized through faith. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are children of God. For you did not receive a spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you have received a spirit of adoption. When we cry, Abba, Father, it is that very spirit bearing witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If in fact we suffer with him so that we may also be glorified with him. For in hope we were saved. Now hope that is seen is not hope. For who hopes for what is seen? But if we hope for what we do not see, we wait for it with patience. Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. We do not know how to pray as we ought, but that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is in the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for good, for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the church.
Joyce and I are so thrilled to be with you folks here this morning. Thank you for welcoming us into your presence. Let us pray. O God, may the utterances of my lips and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. Amen. Brent has just concluded the readings for today, Romans 8:28. We know that all things work together for good for those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. Well, do we know that all things work together for good for those who love God? Some days, maybe. Some days, for sure. Some days, we really question it. The New Testament book of Romans is absolutely for sure Paul. The top grade scholarship assures us of that. When Paul sends off this letter, and I was musing to myself, what a long letter to prepare using the resources that Paul had at his disposal. That's totally amazing, isn't it? Totally. When Paul sends off this letter, Paul is no spring chicken. He has been through a lot. He is sending a word of encouragement to the church at Rome. In their few years of existence, they have seen a lot. Been down in the dumps, wondered about the whole story we now refer to as the Christian faith. Paul writes to them, not so much as a scholar, but as a friend and pastor, sharing with them a certainty he believes with all his head, heart, and soul. All things work together for good for those who love God. This past Thursday, while at rehab, I learned that the husband of my therapist, an RCMP officer, was attending an accident on the Trans-Canada. Back at home, getting a news report on TV, I saw the Albrechtsen helicopter pad at the Health Science Center featured as part of the unfolding tragic drama. I recalled first hearing the name Albrechtsen the very first Sunday being at Gray Street, and your archivist confirmed, was that 2001? An expectant woman was part of the group that had invited Joyce and I to lunch following worship. We have learned the bus that collided was carrying people from Dauphin, Gilbert Plains, and Grandview. When I was ordained, the church sent me to Grandview. As we were, and the newscasts have made a lot of reference to the Humboldt. And driving over here this morning, Joyce has reminded me that I was in your midst right at the time of the Humboldt tragedy. And we were grieving with Luann, or very, very anxious with Luann and her and your family and the tragedy that came out of that. Interconnected, for sure. We are one. To say today to the families of those victims in the fatal accident at Carberry Junction, all things work for good for those who love God, is cruel. More than that, is totally misunderstanding of what Paul is saying. There are things that happen to us we never forget. I was at Emmanuel College, Toronto School of Theology. I had just started classes. My mother phoned me. That day, her son, my brother, had been in a car accident. He and others of a wedding party didn't make it. After the funeral, I returned to Emmanuel, resumed classes as best I could. A fellow first-year student said to me, "Earl, someday you will see how your brother's death has been part of God's plan." I can't remember his name, and that's fortunate. I can't remember much except that I came frightfully close to expressing my anger with his theology by using my fist. It is perhaps noteworthy he never graduated. As I mourned my brother's death, I was experiencing a God who was crying with me. My brother's wife gave birth to a son A month after my brother Donald's tragic death, she named him Donald. My nephew Donald, son of my brother Donald, is a carpenter, is building a ramp for Joyce, and it will get done, Joyce, so she can get in and out of our home more easily. As I sit taking a coffee break and sitting on the front step watching my skilled nephew work, I ask myself, was it God's will that my brother was killed in a car accident? I've had 50 years to think about that. My answer, still, absolutely not. So what does Paul mean when he says to his church, to me, to you, all things work together for good for those who love God? This passage contains the promise that God will restore his violated creation to some form of goodness. But for now, that is just a promise. We have it only in hope. That hope is already the beginning of goodness that is in store for us. It requires of us patience. Yet the hope we have is more than a form of wishful thinking. It is more than ability to persuade ourselves that things will surely be better in the future. The hope we have is trustworthy because we already have a foretaste of its fulfillment in and through the Holy Spirit. The reason the Spirit is a foretaste of the good to come is simply the fact that the Spirit brings us into communion with God. Such communication as we now have with God through God's Spirit is a promise of God's love forever. The good news is that God has sent his Spirit to open those lines of communication. We can have confidence in our future with God only because that future is in God's hands, not ours. To say all things work together for good for those who love God is not some Pollyanna unwillingness to admit evil even when it slaps us in the face. It is the confession that because we are in God's hands, the kind of God who sent his own Son for us, who did not exempt his Son from suffering and death on a cross, that all things will finally resolve into good. Apart from confidence in such a God, we have no reason for optimism about our future. The presence of the Spirit within the community of those faithful to Christ gives us wherewithal to hope against hope. Our Christian hope is grounded in the promise of God, the nature of God. That gives us confidence rather than fear. Hope is an aspect of a faith anchored in the future. Remember the part of the verse, for those who love God. This should not be interpreted to indicate life is rosy if you love God as some kind of a reward. All things work for good for you if you love God means if you are in communion with God, walk with God, you grow more and more into the likeness of God as your life unfolds. Just as it is in God's nature to keep pulling together whatever happens into something good, so it becomes part of your nature to look for the good and make it happen, work towards making it happen in whatever happens in your life. You, Gray Street family congregation, continue to amaze, inspire me. You are facing hardship. I suspect your numbers are diminishing. That means fewer people to fulfill the positions, fewer people to tithe to support paid accountable ministry and look after the building. But you are doing creative things, such as Church-O-Rama. You are no doubt discouraged some days, but do know that things will work for good for you because you live by the Spirit. Remember to pray, even if all you sense is the Spirit interceding with sighs too deep for words. On this day, the secular world calls Father's Day, we, the church, are surely called to support all fathers, to help fathers in the role of being providers, caregivers. No family unit is perfect. It requires a constant diligence to repair, restart, renew the covenant of relationship, calling on God for resources beyond our own. Those who have lost family members at the Carberry Junction this past Thursday will mourn their dead. The loss will be real. It will be painful. For those who believe in the God we share with the world, they will find solace that death is not the end for their loved ones. We believe this to be so regardless of whether known or not. And may the suffering God we know bring those who mourn resources to rebuild, to heal, to carry on. On our agenda today is to rededicate the stained glass that once was part of your church, your chancel windows. It has now been recycled, now four panels, sun catchers in the narthex. The predominant color running through all four panels is red. In the Christian year, red is the color we use to decorate our sanctuary as we celebrate God among us in and through the Holy Spirit. My hope for you is that when you are in the narthex, look up and see the panels, you see and feel the presence of the Holy Spirit. As this glass has been repurposed, be in communion with a God who is forever making all things new, always picking up the pieces, always helping you repurpose your life into a fuller, richer life. Evermore in communion with God and more into the potential God has in store for you. Repurposed by the Spirit. Remember how Paul finishes chapter 8 of his letter to the Romans. May it bring hope and a blessed assurance to us here today as we hear Paul saying to us, we know that all things work together for good for those who love God. Who will separate us from the love of Christ? Will hardship or distress? Paul's word to his church at Rome, to you, to me. here today. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen. Our hymn from More Voices, 165, There Is a Time.
There is a time.
We move to the part of the service, stained glass dedication. We remember Gray Street United Church's roots that brought forth this congregation in 1946. This building coming into being 1951. The service of dedication happening December 2nd, 1951. Changes, upgrades, maintenance over the ensuing years, yes. Your most recent, most significant transformation has necessitated a total replacement of all windows. In wondering what to do with the stained glass from the chancel windows, Brent Poole said to you, Gray Street Saints, leave it to me. The story is on this plaque, which will hang on the wall. The outcome, thanks to family and friends, especially having a wonderful sister-in-law like Joanne Mitchell, and Brent developing a new skill set, the four panels in the narthex shown here on the screen. The contribution, the labors of love that made this project possible have been joyfully offered as a memorial to Barry and Shirley Poole, for whom this was church home for more than 60 years. Let us now rededicate this repurposed glass. Let us pray. O holy God, who came to us in Jesus, who lives among us through your Holy Spirit. It is by your power that all things are made holy. We give you thanks for your marvelous wonders and for the work of human hands. We ask for your blessing as we rededicate this repurposed glass. May these panels be a symbol of how you constantly make all things new. To you be all glory, now and ever. Amen. A gift of music. Spirit, spirit of gentleness. Thank you. God has blessed our lives with relationships, joy, inspiring and challenging. In response to God's blessings in our lives, we offer our time, our talent, our listening, and gifts of money through envelope, e-transfer, and PAR. We sing our offering song and we pray. Life-giving Spirit, bring to the bones of these gifts the flesh of our actions and the breath of our caring, that our church and our service to others may come to life in your name. Amen. And let us continue in prayer. O God, both infinite and intimate, known and unknowable, transcendent and transparent, on this day we come before you knowing you are more than we can know or name, yet we call on you again and again because you forever anew call us to you. We come before you in thanksgiving for all the gifts you have given us, for the lives of those who bless us beyond their knowing, for the community of faith by which we are nurtured and challenged, for opportunities to serve you by serving others, for goals accomplished, for the gift of life yet one more week. We come before you in need for those we know who are suffering today because of illness in mind, body, or spirit, for those trying to make a difficult decision, for those grieving the recent death of a family member or close friend. We especially pray for all those who have died or been injured in the Thursday traffic accident at the Carberry Junction. For those who have lost their lives, we pray in the assurance that you, O God, who raised Jesus from the dead, are now known to them. To those injured, we pray for healing. For those impacted by this tragedy, we pray for your help, O God, to bring them comfort. We pray for all those whose grief is still a daily ache. May your presence be real to them, even in the darkest hour of the darkest night. We pray for healing and strength in every broken place of our lives. We long for the hope you alone can give, hope that does not disappoint us, but rolls away stones of death and despair. We pray for those especially impacted by the erosion of inflation and soaring costs of basic necessities. We come before you crying in the depths of our soul as we pour out to you, O Holy One, the pain, the loss, the futility, the tragedy of war, especially as it is daily brought into our living, the living rooms of our homes. You who cry with us, help us to never, never give up, but to reach out that someday we shall overcome. As the unfolding, unprecedented extremes of drought and flood, heat and wind wreak havoc with our one home, planet Earth, give us ears to hear and resolve to heed the warnings coming from your creation, that we might live into the calling to be your stewards with passion and resolve. Today we offer a special prayer for fathers, asking for the spirit of caring, compassion, wisdom, and self-giving. Give us the gift of a joyful heart, a heart that resonates with your love, that day by day reaches out to us, not in condemnation, but in steadfastness, thereby giving us meaning and purpose all our days. May we delight in living into the maturity of wisdom that comes from 24/7 being with you. And so it is until that day when we each in turn shall see you face to face. Give us a spring in our step and a song in our soul as we 24/7 pray. Our Mother, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our closing hymn this morning is from Voices United 556. Would you bless our homes and families?
Oh, that one.
We follow where the Spirit leads, daring to be risk takers wherever we go.
We are filled with the breath of the Holy Spirit.
May the blessing of God, Creator and Giver of life, the Son, life of God incarnate, and the Holy Spirit, bearer and power of new life among all people, be with us now and forever. Amen.